There are some additional factors you need to take into account if you're going to be using an herbicide. One consideration is whether to use a liquid or granular formulation of the product. The pros of using a liquid are that it's relatively easy to apply to the plant and is good to use for spot treatments. The issue with liquid is that it's sprayed and that it can drift onto non-target plants. Granular products have less of a drift issue. They can also be applied to large areas with a broadcast spreader if it's a pre-emergent. For post-emergent granular herbicides, they need to be able to stick to the leaf to be effective. Usually this means the leaf needs to be a little bit wet. With both liquid and granular herbicides, it's important to check the label for the best temperature to apply. Some can be very specific. Another important consideration is the timing of herbicide application. If you're going to use chemical control, it's best to try and get the most bang for your buck. So you want to apply when weeds are the most susceptible. For perennial weeds, you will be most effective with weed control if you spray when the plant is flowering, when it will transport the herbicide down into the roots, killing the plant. A good time to apply this is often late in the season or after the first frost. At this time, the plant is actively transporting sugars down into the roots for storage, so the herbicide can hitch a ride down to the root, thoroughly killing the plant. A note about applying during the early season. If you're trying to kill a vigorous weed with an herbicide, you may only get the satisfaction of watching it curl up and wither, but you likely won't kill it. The best practice is a late season application in order to minimize chemical usage while still getting the job done. There are also weather considerations. As mentioned earlier, some herbicides have specific temperature requirements noted on the label, but there are also some general guidelines to keep in mind. If the temperatures are too low, this may restrict absorption and translocation through the plant, meaning the plant is less active when it's cool, so it doesn't move the herbicide around the plant. If the temperature is very hot, the herbicide may dry on the surface before it can be even absorbed into the plant in some cases, or it can volatilize or turn into a gas into the air. If temperatures are warm to moderately high, you will generally see the best absorption and translocation, and it will be the most effective. Wind speed is also an important factor to take into account if you're going to be spraying. You should not spray when it's windy outside, but instead wait for a calm day. This reduces the amount of drift onto non-target plants. As always, it's important to be aware of your surroundings and how your actions may be affecting your surroundings. A final word on herbicide labels. As with all pesticides, read the label for usage restrictions and handling regulations, and look for precautionary labels on containers. Keep all pesticides in original containers and locked up where children cannot get them. And do not eat, drink, or smoke while handling pesticides. If you have leftovers, dispose of unused products as directed. As a Master Gardener volunteer, you'll need to be able to not only make decisions about weed management in your own garden, but you'll need to be able to discuss control options with others. While you may have personal opinions about the use of one control method over another, it's important to be able to discuss the pros and cons of each method with the public. We do, however, recommend considering cultural and mechanical options before you resort to chemical options. But overall, try to minimize chemical usage. This philosophy should be considered with all pest management options you give. To conclude, we ask again, what is a weed? When weeding, the best way to make sure you are removing a weed and not a valuable plant is to pull on it. If it comes out of the ground easily, it's a valuable plant.